So we've got introduction, that what we're covering tonight. And so introduction sort of covers everything anyway. But I just want to show you the package. Next week, we're going to look at accounting diversity and the reasons, problems, and frameworks. But why do we get differences around the world? Many of you are interested in working for a Big Four accounting firm or some consulting firm or some investment bank or some bank. Put your hand up. Any one of them, you're going to be impacted by international accounting in some way. An international accounting firm, wow, they have to know so many different standards. Why? Because there's no country in the world that is doing accounting in the same way. There's a lot of countries now that have adopted IFRS, but they don't always adopt everything in IFRS. Okay? China has adopted IFRS, but in a much more stringent fashion than what Hong Kong has. Did you know that? So we're going to talk about that in week three. All right? Do you think that's worthwhile knowing, right? Because you're in China, you're in Hong Kong. So you need to know that. Good. So that's positive. Then in week four, color. Aaron did some nice color for us. All right, so we've got red. All right, red, week four, accounting for foreign exchange. All right, multinationals have to, normally, if they're not in the business of finance, they will have hedging instruments or options to manage their foreign exchange exposure risk. Okay. And we'll talk about that. What is that? What does that mean? And how can you account for that? And what does that mean for the profit and loss and balance sheet? So we're going to talk about that in week four. Okay? In week five, foreign currency translation. So what if I want to compare a company in Hong Kong with a company in the USA? Well, the company in the USA follows GAAP. The company in Hong Kong follows IFRS. So now I need to translate the Hong Kong company. Well, let me just change it up a little bit. Okay, the Hong Kong company is not in US dollars. Okay, it's in Hong Kong dollars. Now, okay, so Hong Kong and US has got a fixed exchange rate. But if it was a floating exchange rate, I would have to change the currency into the US dollar. It gets more complicated if the exchange rate has changed over the accounting period. So if you're comparing a Chinese company in yuan with a US company, the yuan has gone up or down in the last 6 months. It's gone down, all right? So therefore, cash held 6 months ago has a different value in US dollars than cash held today, you see? So we need to be able to have a way of converting a profit and loss and balance sheet of a Chinese company so we can compare it with a US company if we're going to make a decision about investment. When we get to here, we need to analyze foreign financial statements. This is about translating differences in accounting standards. Okay, so in the US, they don't allow the pooling of interest method when it comes to acquisitions. Whereas in China, they allow some form of the pooling of interest. So then you may have to make that adjustment to compare a Chinese company with a US company. See, that's different. Here, you make an adjustment because the companies are in different currencies. You with me? Here, we're going to give you some understanding of how to make adjustment because countries are using different standards. Okay? See the difference? All right, and then when we get to here, international taxation, we will have guests coming in from Big Four to talk to you about the latest international taxation challenges, like BEPS. Okay, very, very interesting. Put your hand up if you're looking forward to that. Yeah, me too. Yes, and if that's not enough, we'll get some more partners to come in the second week. Because there's a lot to cover, all right? We can't just do everything in 1 week. It's a very big topic. It's a lot of issues. And then we go to transfer pricing. We'll get someone in, another person to come in talk about transfer price. No, it's not to replace me. Of course, I'll give my lecture every week, okay? All right? Don't worry. I love to talk, all right? I will not replace be replaced by anyone else, all right? And we've got SOX. We may not even have time to cover Sarbanes-Oxley, but we may get to talk about it during this semester. All right, so that's our roadmap. Put your hand up if this sort of gives you a bit more clarity about what this course is about. Does this help you? Ah, good. It helps me, so I thought it might help you. Okay. Okay. With chapter one, we can go through each PowerPoint slide, but I want to emphasize, and if you watch my YouTube video, it's quite, so for some of you might think, oh, it's a little bit slow, it's a bit dull and not very exciting compared to other YouTube videos out there. I can tell you, yeah, definitely, all right? But remember, the whole purpose of the YouTube video is not to replace me. It's not so I can just not do anything on a Monday night. It's to help you just get the terminology right. So when you come in talking, then you feel a bit more confident to ask questions, okay, and have a discussion in class, rather than you've seen this for the first time and you're starstruck and then suddenly the Monday night is over, okay? I don't think that is a good model. So there's the learning objectives of Chapter 1, and it's more the whole scope of international accounting. If every country was the same, they had the same tax treaty, they all had the same economic environment, they all had the same culture, we wouldn't have international accounting. There wouldn't be any differences. The fact that we have this unit arises because there's differences. And basically, at the end of this unit, you'll have a greater understanding about what do these differences mean for the operation of a multinational. What do these differences mean for a Big Four accounting firm that's deciding whether they should do an audit for a Chinese company? Okay? Or what does it mean for deciding to do an audit for a multinational? Or doing an IPO, due diligence for a company. And interesting, I met two companies in the last 2 weeks across the border in China who are planning to do their IPO. And both of them, I think they're going to go through the Shenzhen exchange. But what if they decide to do the IPO in USA? Well, then suddenly there's international tax concerns you've got to think about. And there's financial reporting issues you've got to think about. Because suddenly the firm's profits, all in Chinese, now have to be translated into US. Why? Because you're trying to attract investors from USA. You with me here? All right, so this is really important. We've got 900 plus Chinese, oh, I forget now, I lose track. It's in the hundreds that Chinese companies that are listed in New York, okay? In the hundreds. And it's significant. It's a significant amount. China has the largest population of foreign companies that are listed in New York out of all the countries in the world. Okay? So this matters very much for IPOs of the company. It matters for international accounting. So we can talk about how international accounting issues arise. And we talk about sale to a foreign customer. And the first encounter in international business occurs when a foreign customer pays you money. Or how many of you have done any sourcing or have friends that do sourcing? Like a middleman between factories in China and customers overseas. Well, what you'll find is that when customers overseas, they come to the factory and the conversation goes, okay, I want, what's your MOQ, your minimum order quantity? Oh, 1,000. Oh, how much per unit? Oh, maybe $5 per unit. There's 5,000. And you think, oh, is that US dollar or yuan? I'm sorry. Oh, Mr. Customer, that's US dollar. That's not yuan. All right. So suddenly it's 5,000 US dollars. It's not 5,000 yuan. Ah. And so now the supplier thinks, oh, Mr. Customer, if we open an account where you don't pay for 3 months, you'll have to pay more, okay? If you pay today, it's 5,000 US dollar. Ah, so now it starts to get more complicated depending on when the money is going to be paid, because the supplier's thinking, maybe the yuan goes up in the next 3 months, my 5,000 US dollars is going to be worth less. Are you with me here? Or it could be the other way around, like what's happened in the last 3 months. No one can predict what's going to happen in the next 3 months. If you're a manufacturer, sometimes you've got to just hedge that risk. So this is where international accounting starts out. It starts out when you've got a basic sale to a foreign customer. Or credit sales are made to the foreign customer who will pay in their own currency. It gives rise to foreign exchange risk. So all the way up until the start of this year, when the yuan was slowly appreciating, it did appreciate, didn't it? It went all the way down to about 6.1 to the US dollar. Now it's up 6.4 to US dollar. And some people are saying within the next 12 months it's going to be up to 6.8 per US dollar. All right, so you can see it's going one way. Okay, so then if you're a manufacturer in China, you're happy to get a foreign currency. Why? Because your own currency is going down. You with me? But what about year before, the year before that? Would you think the same way? No. All right, because your yuan, your currency, is keeping getting stronger and stronger. So you always had that in the back of your mind. Oh, you better pay us in yuan because your US dollar is going to be 10% weaker in 12 months' time. That was the case 2011, 2012. Okay, so different years cause different risks. And this is the currency risk that we're talking about. I like this button. It doesn't work. Okay, so we could now, let me just give you a warning. We can talk about the yuan US dollar exchange rate, but I don't want you to feel that, oh, I don't understand this. This is not yuan and US dollar. What do I do? All right, what you need to think about is what is the currency of the buyer and what is the currency of the seller? Okay. In this case, the Joe Inc., it's a US company, makes a sale and ships goods to Mexico. So what does that mean? So we've got goods and it's in the USA and it goes to Mexico. All right. So the Mexico customer promised us to pay $100,000, is that right? Yes or no? All right. So we're going to spend more time on this in week 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, week 4. But I just want to give you a basic example now. All right. And it says, it's agreed Joe's will pay March 1, 2014, which is 1 month later, because on February the 1st, the sale was made. So, on February 1, sale was made. Okay, this payment happens on March 1, all right? 30 days later, on February the 1st, what is the exchange rate? 1 to 10, right? Yes, okay? That's not exchange rate here when it's paid. So at this date, there are two dates. February the 1st, first date. Second date is March 1. My counting's not perfect, so just bear with me here. All right? So when you make a basic sale, what's the debit and credit? I want you to write it down now. Have you got it? I want you to write down. What would be the debit and credit for a basic credit sale? All right? There's nothing tricky here. What's the basic credit sale, debit and credit? You're not receiving cash. You're just creating something else. What are you creating? Accounts receivable, right? So what do? We debit accounts receivable, right? Okay, so accounts receivable. Okay, so I think it's 100,000. That should be, and then sales, right? 100,000, is that right? Right. So this is February 1, but in March 1, hopefully what happens is bank. We get our money. Yes, I want my money. So hopefully I get my money, and hopefully it's 100,000. All right, and you debit bank and credit accounts receivable. Is that right? Class. Yes or no? We're good? All right, just, it's very simple tonight. Don't, okay, I can't handle any more complications anyway, so I'll keep it simple for you. All right, so we have our basic accounts receivable, credit, sales. All right, so this is recorded at date of February the 1st. So now, on March 2nd, what happens is, oh, the exchange rate is now, one US dollar is 11 pesos. Pesos is the Mexican currency. So has the pesos gotten stronger or weaker? Got weaker. It's just like when the yuan went from, yeah, it's gone from 6.1 to 6.4 in the last 6 months. Yuan has gotten weaker against the US dollar. Exactly the same. Peso's gone from 10 now to 11. Okay? So, on March, we're not going to, accounts receivable is 100,000, but I'm sorry, the bank is not going to get 100,000. I'm sorry about that. The bank is only going to get 90,909. Okay? Because of the currency difference. All right? And so what do you do? You have loss on foreign exchange. Ah, so where does that go? Traditionally, when you're accounting for losses or gains on foreign exchange, under conservative accounting, you have two choices. Number one, you can send it to the income statement. Number two, you can send it to the balance sheet. If you're going to be conservative, where do we send a loss on foreign exchange? Where do we send it? To be conservative, it goes straight to the income statement. All right? Conservative. A loss goes straight to the income statement, bang, pushes the profits down. That's being conservative. Okay? All right? However, when you have a gain, traditionally, to be conservative, you want to send that to the balance sheet. All right? Because you don't want the profits to be just appreciate immediately by that gain. Okay, so conservative accounting would send the loss to the income and the profit to the balance sheet. So you keep, okay, we're jumping ahead here, and this is kind of week four stuff. All right, it's giving you a little bit of a something to think about. Okay, all right. By the way, what we will be doing will not be much more complicated than this. Okay? What's more important is that you understand the mechanics. Okay, so let's keep moving here. So we have a lot of techniques to make sure that our vendor in the USA gets his or her 100,000. What can we do? We have two techniques. One is we can have an option. Okay, we can have a foreign currency option. And most investment banks can help organize this. Banks will do this for you. The other way is to have a forward contract. And a forward contract tends to be much more popular. And basically, if you have a bank account with HSBC or the international banks, they will allow you as a personal account to have a margin trading with foreign exchange. Put your hand up if you know what that is. Yeah, so you only got a little bit of money, but you trade with lots and lots of money. So you can make lots and lots of profit or lots and lots of losses. All right? It will multiply your profits or losses. Well, exactly what you're doing there, you're actually hedging. If you have another transaction to go against it. That's all a hedge is, all right? And so we're going to talk about that in week four, all right? Forward contracts, this is the main part we're going to focus on, not options. Let's keep moving. So we've got foreign direct investment, and we want to talk about ownership and control of foreign assets. Traditionally, the first time I went to China was in, was it 25 years ago, 25 years ago, all right, 1990, 桂林山水甲天下，还有，so Beijing, Xi'an, Shanghai, Hangzhou, or went all around. That was 25 years ago. What I noticed back then, and I came to Hong Kong in 1996, so I've been here for 20 years about. Okay, back then, a lot of the foreign investment in China was through joint venture. Seriously, it was a joint venture. And it was really interesting that, number one, because the China government wouldn't allow foreign wholly owned subsidiary, except there was only one company that I know back then, this is in the 90s, that had a foreign owned subsidiary in China, and that was Oracle. Isn't that interesting? Wow, that was Oracle, yeah. You know Oracle? Huh? Yes, Oracle. Okay, but suddenly they soon changed to joint venture because they realized that most of their customers weren't consumers but were the education departments and other state-owned enterprises. In order to do business with them, they sort of had to have a joint venture. All right, so they actually changed to joint ventures to make sure that they can sustain their sales growth. All right, so a lot of foreign companies going into China did joint venture. It wasn't an acquisition. It was sort of like an investment, it was like a joint investment, so your partnership. Whereas if you look in the last years in China, a lot of that foreign investment going into China has been wholly owned subsidiary. Okay? So a friend of mine in Shenzhen has a wholly owned subsidiary. He's American. And he has a factory there, and it has 200 employees. Okay? I'll show you the video on Thursday about that. Because nothing to do with what we're talking about tonight, all right? So, greenfield investment, new operation in foreign companies in countries, this is increasingly common in China too, okay? Because now foreign companies can take advantage of the internet and other channels of sales in China. So it enables them to do many more things they couldn't do 10 years ago, 15 years ago. Okay, let's keep moving. Reasons, why do companies invest? Why do they? There are many different reasons. I want you to think about it. Increased sales and profits. Because at home, nothing's happening. All right? So all of the factories I talk to in China, the people, they want to go overseas. Why do you want to go overseas? Oh, because home is not growing as fast as I want in terms of high margin products. Okay? The traditional volume, low margin, is kind of stagnating, there's too much competition or some other reason. So they want to go international. And they want advice. How do we sell international? So they go international to increase sales and profits. They want to enter rapidly growing or emerging markets. A factory I was talking to last week is going to Brazil. They feel, you know, they're focusing on that for the last 3 or 4 years. At the moment, Brazil is entering a recession. But in the long term, Brazil has a lot of growth opportunities, okay, being an emerging market. Okay, reduce costs, gain a foothold in economic blocks. So we've got the BRICS, you know, Brazil, China, India, Russia. Okay, and then there was others that came out with South Africa, Mexico. So these become very important. Sometimes companies will invest overseas to protect the domestic market. Because by investing overseas, you actually learn faster and enables you to innovate faster for your domestic market. If you didn't go overseas, you wouldn't learn and you'll get overtaken by the competition. Okay? So that's in some ways, that's a learning motivation. Or to protect foreign markets. You protect foreign markets, you go overseas, you want to go in early earlier than what you need because you just want to have that first mover advantage. But you're not going to make money for 5 or 10 or 15 years. That's what Volkswagen did in China 40 years ago. All right? Volkswagen. Remember, up until about 8 or 10 years ago, the only taxi in China was a Volkswagen. Right? Why? Because Volkswagen was the first major foreign car in China back in the late 80s, mid-80s. Okay. All right. Did they make money in the early stages? No. All right. But now they got that brand influence and everything like that. They make money, you see. So acquire technological and managerial know-how. Yes, a lot of Chinese companies won't go overseas, so they can do that, and vice versa. Okay. Very good. Let's keep moving. I've just given you examples as we go through it. Financial reporting. Steps in reporting. This is very interesting. Conversion from local to GAAP and then translate local currency to US dollars. That's very interesting because in week 5, we do step 2. In week 6, we do step 1. I know it's the other... all right, so that's the... I want you to make a note of that. All right, in week 5, we're doing step 2. In week 6, we're doing step 1. Okay? Because that's the way the book is organized. So I don't know why the book puts it that way. But it says, the first must do the accounting statement conversion, all right, and then you'll translate the currency. Okay. All right. We don't have the bandwidth this semester to go into every detail on all the standards. All right, we could only just give you one or two or three examples at the most. Okay, so you won't be floored by everything you have to remember. Okay, but understand the mechanics, right? This is a mechanic, step 1, step 2. You with me? That's a mechanic. You want to get the mechanics this semester, okay? Double R taxation, my favorite. I love taxation. I think I might do more of this. We should have 4 weeks on taxation. Put your hand up if you think that's a good idea. My friends at KPMG, they want to talk to me this week about, I'm writing a report for them, and they said, they want to talk about beeps and transfer pricing concerns. I'm thinking, wow, that's interesting. Wow. It's not just a professor that doesn't know anything about the world that thinks it's interesting. But when the big four realize, you know, they contact you and say, well, focus your report on these issues, have these issues in your report, then that means you should be learning that, right? Yeah? Cool. All right, so we'll have partners come in, managers come in, talk about double taxation, tax treaties. Okay, let me ask you now, are you better off when you get your job and you're making lots of money, are you better off in Hong Kong or China in terms of your after-tax income?
Hong Kong.
Why?
The tax rate is very low in Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm. Okay, what if the tax rate in Hong Kong was exactly the same as China? Would you be better off in Hong Kong or China, the after-tax income?
China.
Why? No. Everything else being equal. Pardon? Would you be better off? Put your hand up. You think you're better off in China? Better off Hong Kong? Or not sure? Not sure. All right. Tax rate's the same.
Hong Kong does not have that
import
tax.
You're getting on this. And give me some more example.
Luxury foods.
Oh, okay, yeah, customs duty, things like that. Okay, even that aside, all right? Put that aside, all right? Let me make it a little bit easier, all right? You have an investment for example, you have a bank in the US and it pays you dividends, okay? All right? And you get money. And maybe you have an E-Trade account in the US and then you're making some stock gains every quarter, all right? All right? Tax is the same in Hong Kong, tax is the same in China. Are you better off in China or Hong Kong? Why?
Because Hong Kong tax just the taxation is, they China, the government gets tax from the profits or income from mainland China and the people who is China, whose nationality is China.
Okay. If you're in China, right, you're taxed on all your earnings from all over the world. All right? And if you're in Hong Kong, you're just taxed on your Hong Kong income. That's why I like Hong Kong. Another reason to stay in Hong Kong. Yeah, because you might have a property in another country. All right? And that country might tax you anyway. There might be some double tax agreement or something like that. But at the end of the day, if you're in Hong Kong, you don't have to worry about that in your tax return. Of course, you may have to pay tax in the other country, but you still have to do that in China. But in China, it gets more complicated because you still need, now you need to declare that and try and get a credit through some other way. Okay? Did you know that? Yeah. So don't run back to China so quickly, all right? All right. Okay? So we're going to cover that in, 5, 6, 7, then we've got 8 and 9. And you can ask questions directly to the managers that come in and talk with you. All right, you need to know this, okay? Because you're at a stage where you're totally mobile and you may want to try to build up your wealth as quick as you're possible in the next 3 or 4 or 5 years, okay? So that may affect you. And then there's tax treaties that provide relief from double taxation, and now we've got BEPS. That's, do you know what BEPS is? BEPS, base erosion profit shifting. This is what multinationals have been doing for the last 10 years, and now all the members of the OECD have decided enough is enough, and we're going to get these multinationals. You try and save tax by having shifting profits into Ireland, into Hong Kong, into Singapore, and into Luxembourg, where the tax rate is very, very, very low. Okay, we're going to revise the tax that you owe. Okay, have you heard about that? Did you hear about Starbucks, what Starbucks was doing? What did you hear? So you know that Starbucks actually, I think it was 2 years ago in the UK, 18 months ago, it reported no income in the UK for its tax. Zero tax. How can it do that? It sold millions of coffees and paying no tax. It was totally obvious, right? Because their Ireland subsidiary was charging their UK subsidiary interest expense. They had a loan from Ireland. So therefore, some of the profits go off as interest expense. Suddenly, tax income goes down. Ah, how can we get it down lower? Ah, we'll get our subsidiary in Netherlands to charge a royalty fee. Okay? So when we get to weeks 10, 11, interest, dividends, and royalties are the mechanisms by which multinationals use to move money around. Yes, tax rate goes up, let's move it around, move it over to somewhere else. That's what they're doing. And so now all the countries, the OECD, realize, oh, this is not fair. It's not fair. We have our tax rate at 30%, but multinationals declare no income tax and they pay nothing. So they're restructuring how they can claw back money from these multinationals. How many of you got an iPhone? Yeah? Did you buy it in China or Hong Kong?
Hong Kong.
Hong Kong? Why is it cheaper in Hong Kong? Oh, because of customs duty. But many other things. I've got a friend that will come in and talk about that transfer pricing in week 11. Okay? Yes. So, very exciting. I love the taxation. We're going to put your hand up if you love the taxation part. I'm glad you love it. Good. We'll spend more time on it. And then we've got international transfer pricing. Little things like While we're on taxation, this is what your project is going to be about. Since you like it, then that's perfect. All right, 35% project, focusing on transfer pricing / taxation. Okay, and basically the project is you get to compare China with another country that you choose for a particular structure of making something and selling it to the USA. Okay, and then you've got to do the comparison. Where should you put your factory? Should you have a separate subsidiary to manage sales and things like that? Okay, so this is part of your project that you will do. International transfer pricing. Then we've got performance evaluation and foreign operations. What are we going to do there? We won't have much time for this, but in a nutshell, this is where, if you're a subsidiary manager in a country, do I evaluate your performance in terms of, was an idea that was interesting to you? Did you learn something in my first hour of talking? Yes or no? Did you get an idea that you didn't have before? Yes or no? Then just write that down, because I want to know what your things that are interesting to you or that you get, because sometimes when us professors, we get old, we kind of think you know everything anyway. But I think I know what you know, but I don't know until you write it down. You with me? Huh? All right, so this is just to help me. Okay, what's the big idea? Maybe you didn't learn nothing big today, then write that down. But hopefully there's something there, all right? So let's go around the class just for, let's pick three people, okay? Three volunteers to tell me, is there one big idea you got for the first hour today? And what was that? I'm the second one at the moment, the big idea, okay? So let me help warm you up a little bit. Okay, I'll read out some of the ideas that last year's class had, okay? All right, good idea? Okay, let me read out. Okay, so Li Pai Yu wrote, the loss or gain on foreign exchange derived from a delay in payment, cash transaction does not exist such problem. Remember when we showed the peso, the sale, and that? The only reason why we had a foreign exchange gain or loss because there was a separation between the time the transaction took place and the time cash was paid. Okay, if you receive cash on the day the transaction takes place, then you never have a foreign exchange problem. All right. So that was simple. That was an idea that this person got, and then that's good, right? Something little like that. That's the idea. Okay, who else got an idea? Let's have a look. Anne Tsai said, I have known what is international accounting. During international transactions, we only record gain or loss when cash is not received at the time of the transaction. Okay, so we've got gains or losses because there's a delay between when you receive cash and when you book the transaction. Two other ideas, someone else. Here we are, Ling Meng Jun. In the normal multinational business, it needs to account revenue and cash items. Meanwhile, it generated gain and loss in transactions due to exchange rate. So interesting that some of them are picking up on this idea here. But what ideas did you get that you sort of felt you didn't know much before? Who would like? Pardon?
If you actually host of the internet companies in China, and you don't have
any other assets,
I don't know
what that's
for, but it's interesting.
Oh, the VIE. Yes, so you're in China. Here's Baidu. Baidu, right? Do you all use Baidu?
Yeah.
Is that right? All right. No, that's the ticker in NASDAQ, Baidu. Okay. All right. So what happens is a NASNY, no, it's NASDAQ. Okay? Okay, so you got investors, they put their money into NASDAQ. That money goes into a holding company in Cayman Islands. The money goes here. Okay? The money does not go to here directly. Ah, interesting. Now, when Baidu listed, okay, yes, they got the money. They can take the initial listing money and use it to buy assets here. Okay, so some, you know, the money, cash will go over here. You with me? But remember, when Baidu listed, which was 5+ years ago, it listed at around $100 US. Did you know that? So what's its value today? Its value today is $207 US dollar. Just a minute. Times 10. Because it had a 10-for-1 split. So it went from 100 to 2070. Okay. And you're probably thinking, wow, I've got shares in Baidu, the $100 now is 2070, I'm a stockholder here, so is this asset that I have a share in, you know, which is basically the all the offices and all their infrastructure and, you know, they've got assets and they've got current assets, they've got working capital, they've got sales offices, right throughout China, right? Okay, their assets, the balance sheet. But this shareholder does not have control over that. Because under Chinese law, all right, foreigners are not allowed to have control over any internet company, any internet asset. That's the law. Okay, so what we do, yes, Mr. Foreigner, you have a share in this VIE, so we can split this up and we sell the VIE to NASDAQ, okay? Now the VIE, how does the VIE give dividends to these shareholders? Or how does the VIE go from $100 up to 2070? Because that's what you got a share of, right? How does it go from here to here? Well, this VIE provides services to Baidu China. All right, so Baidu China pays for those services every month. It pays money to here. Then that money notionally becomes part of that VIE balance sheet. And that's how it's accounted for. And that's how Baidu does it. And that's how Tencent does it with Hong Kong. Tencent's on the Hong Kong Stock Exchange. But they still have Cayman Islands company, right? Because no Hong Kong person can have control of internet in China too, all right? Because foreigners are allowed to invest in the Hong Kong Stock Exchange, all right? So Tencent cannot do this either. They cannot, they have to do what Baidu does. Alibaba does the same, okay? Interesting, put your hand up, this interesting. Yeah, is that good, cool? Yes. All right. I want, in next week or probably in 2 weeks' time, I'll try and get Paul Gillis, who is an ex-partner of PwC of 16 years in Beijing. He's now at Beijing Beida, and he's an adjunct professor there. And he knows all about the happenings of accounting in China. So hopefully, if we can't get him in live, like in terms of Skype, then I'll record an interview and bring that into the classroom, okay? But he has lots of interesting stories to tell about the China companies. Okay, so you tell me, what other ideas did you get tonight? Let's start over here. Yes? Yes? And your name? Wan Xing. Ni shang de sema? What are you thinking? Structure, okay.
I also think there's some topics.
Which topic most interests you?
The taxation.
Okay.
I also learn the currency problems and learn the laws. And the
game. I get that, but to you, what was the most interesting thing you learnt personally? What was the most interesting thing to you? Okay. Well, yeah. Give me a few weeks. We'll actually spend a bit more time on that. Yes. And actually, the textbook has a very good summary of that in chapter 6. It has China, Japan, Germany. I think one or two other countries, but we just look at the China part only. We don't look at all of them. Okay. Yes. Okay. Yes. Down the front. Big idea. Big idea did you get? Pardon?
Same as her.
Yes. Which was?
VIE.
The VIE. Okay, all right.
It's about income tax regulations difference in mainland China and Hong Kong.
Yeah. I nearly once took a job in Suzhou. You know Suzhou? Suzhou? There was a university there. They offered me a professorship there, just out of Shanghai, about 1 hour out. I'm thinking, man, I think back then they give you a tax holiday for 1 or 2 years, but after that, then they suck in all your income all overseas. You've got to declare and report, you know. Yes. Wow, I'm glad I'm in Hong Kong. Yes. Okay. Anyone else? Yes. Big idea. Oh, the Starbucks one. Oh, wow, that's just the tip of the iceberg.
Many international companies always do their report to the public image, and they said they pay much attention on social responsibility. So they always said they are they think much about the charity. But actually, they may even pay.
Right. Yes. Now that's a very good point. And so I didn't even tell you about what happened with Apple. You know what Apple does, don't you? Like, they have so much money outside the USA because they have so many sales. And in China, they have a lot of money, cash in China. And so what we're going to learn in taxation is that as soon as Apple pays. See, Apple has subsidiaries all over the world. And when those subsidiaries, if they pay a dividend to Apple, all right, back in the US, then they have to pay tax on that dividend received because that's income. So what Apple does is, no, don't pay a dividend, you just keep massing the money, and it's about $36 billion more dollars in cash it's got in overseas. What it does is goes to NYSC, the stock exchange, and issues a bond for $18 billion or so much, and then gets the money that way, and just creates another liability to offset against its cash on the other side of the planet that it could get, but if it did get, it's going to have to pay 30% odd tax on that. So it's better for them just to create more liabilities and just keep that cash overseas. And that's very contentious in the US at the moment because some politicians are saying, if I get elected, I'm going to give a low rate of tax so all these multinationals will bring their money back home. Because at the moment, they're not bringing their money home. And that's a big issue at the moment. And that's what Apple's doing. Okay? So you need to... this taxation part, I think, is super interesting. Super, super, super interesting. Yes. Okay. One more from the back row. Yes? What was the big idea to you? What was your big... what big idea did you get tonight?
Actually, I found that if we can introduce the difference of the regulation about the country of taxation in different countries, we can make great difference. And such as, as you mentioned, some examples, such as when we are your Starbucks, we can make more profit. We can make more profit and perhaps cut our cost by taking good use of the regulation.
Yes, Starbucks did a great idea. They did something good, right? Like, they didn't have to pay tax in the UK. Isn't that a great idea? But what happened is the public in the UK, guess what? They started protesting. And someone started a movement to boycott Starbucks. So in the end, Starbucks had to change their accounting and they decided to pay tax in the UK. So the question I have for you is, did Starbucks change because the UK changed their law or because of social pressure? Because of social pressure. Ah, but what about Apple? Apple's not changing. Apple's not changing. What's the difference? It's a different product. You see Starbucks coffee every day. You stop buying that. Starbucks feels the heat. But your iPhone, you're not going to boycott that big purchase you make every 2 years, aren't you? Right? You see? So Apple can get away with it because you're not giving any social pressure. You see? It's harder. It's harder for you to do that. It's easier for you to go to Pacific Coffee and avoid Starbucks, right? And say you're boycotting Starbucks. But what are you going to do with Apple? I go to Samsung, Android. Oh, no, too much effort. I'm not going to do that. All right. So this is some of the dilemmas that governments, foreign governments have. Because for some companies... And then Amazon's another one. Okay. And Netflix is another one. Big issue in Australia. People are buying movies online in Australia and Netflix is making foreign profits taken out of Australia and everyone's up in arms in Australia. Oh, you can't do that, you've got to pay your taxes in Australia. And so, yeah, with the internet, it's created all these troubles, especially for those developed countries that have high tax rates, like 30% or more. The average tax rates for a lot of the OECD countries has gone down from 35% to 40% down to below 25%, 20% over the last 10 or 15 years, except for the USA, except for Australia, except for some of the other developed countries. In the USA, I think it's still around 35%. They haven't reduced it. But Singapore has gone down. Malaysia, it's gone down. Hong Kong, they've kept it low. All right? Did you know up until about 12 months ago, Hong Kong was blacklisted? It was on the blacklist of as a tax haven. So if you're blacklisted and registered as a tax haven, this is by the EU, European Union, then you cannot get any benefits in terms of tax credits or double taxation write-offs and things like that. Okay? But it's now... it's now been released from that blacklisted status because now Hong Kong has agreed to the OECD statement, all the partners joined, to share all its bank information, tax information to other countries if they inquire to Hong Kong, oh, Mr. Joe Blow in such and such bank, can you tell us about any big transactions he's had in the last 12 months? And then Hong Kong, the IRD have to disclose that now. See, once Hong Kong agreed to do that, now they're no longer blacklisted. Wow, isn't it? This course should just be called taxation, right? I think it'd be very interesting. All right, enough of, but we're going to spend a lot of time on that in weeks 8, 9, 10, 11, all right? So we'll get in a little bit more detail, and we'll have lots of experts in to talk to you about that. Put your hand up. Is that a good idea? Yeah, good idea? Great, I like that. Okay. You don't want to listen to me for 10, 12 weeks. I'll drive you crazy. All right, so international auditing, I love the SOX area. I have a working paper. I could force you to read it. You can read it if you want to. All right, just I can make it available so you can have a look at that. We've done some work in that area. That's auditing. We're just finishing up on some of these slides. This notion of cross-listing. How many of you know what cross-listing means? I think we're near the second last page of the PowerPoint slides. How many of you know what cross-listing is? Let me give you an example, like China Mobile. All right, it's listed in Hong Kong, yes? It's listed in, I think it's listed in Shanghai and also in NASDAQ. Did you know that? NYC. It's in New York. That's in Hong Kong. All right, so when it's listed in overseas, it's actually listed as an ADR. Not a direct listed. It's not a reverse merger. It's an ADR. Do you know what that means? It's an American Depository Receipt. Okay, so it's not a direct list. It's not a reverse merger. It's an ADR. Okay, so we have that direct listed, reverse merger, ADR. Okay, so an ADR is similar, it's like a mutual fund. It's kind of like an ETF, an exchange-traded fund, all right? Of course, the stock gets the benefit of that because it broadens the shareholder base. And so basically an ADR is sort of like a package of 10 or 100 of Hong Kong shares, and it's put together and then it's sold as a share lot in the stock exchange in New York. Okay, so ADRs are always cross-listed. In other words, they have a share, China Mobile's in Hong Kong and it's in New York. Okay, Baidu is that listed in China? I don't think so. So Baidu is not cross-listed, you see. Baidu is just direct-listed in New York. Okay? All right. Alibaba is not cross-listed either. Okay? Do you know why? Because China securities laws wouldn't allow Jack Ma to have a dual class share structure, because Jack Ma wants to have the power, you know, control. Okay, he wants a minimum share but lots of control. All right, and Hong Kong said no also, but New York said yes, come give us your money. All right, and so Alibaba is still direct listed. All right, so Baidu, okay, Alibaba, okay, but there is a lot of Chinese companies that are reverse mergers. These are the dangerous ones. These are the ones where I can explain what a reverse merger is, and that is when a Chinese company, they want to invest, like Baidu, use a VIE, but it is above the board. All the shareholders know that this was created, this Cayman Islands company was created, and they got a share of that. But with a reverse merger, the company in China will actually go to a shell that's already on the NASDAQ, but it hasn't been, it's dormant, it hasn't been operating. And so what happens is they buy this shell, or they give money to this shell and then they get this shell to buy the Chinese company. All right, the money goes to the Chinese company. And then they do a reverse merger. In other words, this shell buys the Chinese company, this company actually, Chinese company, buys shares in this shell. So what you got in the end is a sort of a two-stage. The China company is here, but really the China company owns the shares in this shell company that actually owns the Chinese company. That's a reverse merger, backwards. All right. Why do you do that? Because you don't have to pay so much money for the IPO. You don't have to do IPO. Why? Because the shell company is already listed. It's already there. All right. And you don't have to go through this IPO process where you have to pay $1 million more to auditors, to the investment bankers, so they can get investors on board. You can start small and then grow. And a lot of Chinese companies did that back in 2010, 2011, then 2012. A guy called Carson Block came out from Muddy Waters and said, Sinoforest is worth nothing, short it. And so he shorted it, he made lots of money. And then a lot of hedge fund managers started thinking, oh, where's the next one we can short? You know, where's the next reverse merger we can short? And then, you know, because they find that they've got nothing there, there's no assets. It was a sham. There was nothing in the Chinese company for this reverse merger to buy. But there was money being paid up by investors for this shell. They were getting money from stockholders, but there was no assets. So a lot of hedge funds come along and said, oh, let's short these companies. We'll make lots of money. Have you heard about what happened then? That was back in 2012, 2013. Wow. You know? Okay, so my job is to try and give you some stories. And I said I'll finish at 9:30, I promise you. And the main thing is that when we start next week, next week is probably a theoretical basis where we're going to talk about what are the reasons for why we have so many differences out there, or what are the problems that are caused because of these differences. Like problems like, because a big four, if it actually audits a Hong Kong company, then you're working for the big four, you're doing the audit, then you have a standard you have to follow. But if suddenly you have to go and do audit on a Chinese company, then there's a different standard. And suddenly they send you down to Malaysia. Now there's a different standard you have to know. So that costs money for the big four accounting firm because there's less mobility of their labor. And they have to do more training because there's all these differences. So we're going to talk about that next week. We're going to talk about these costs of having all of these differences around the world. We're going to talk about the reasons why they do exist, and we're going to share with you some frameworks that are out there to help you make sense of it, okay? Because there's a lot of information out there, all right? That's what we're going to do next week. Mm. Now, have you all done your groups, yes or no? Okay. And you can finish filling out, if you have a question here, write down a question. So at the beginning of next week, I'll read out some questions and try and answer some of them, okay? So if you can spend that 5 minutes just finishing that would be really, really appreciated. Put your name on top, or if you can, that would be great, yes. Mm. How many of you are in the afternoon session on Thursday, section 1, and the evening session? Anyone? Evening session. Okay, good. Excellent. I'm still finalising the major assessment for Thursday, because it depends. So let me give you an example. In April, I had the same class. It was for Masters of Accounting, but it's the same class, Strategic Management Accounting. But it started in trimester three, so that's April to June, right? So do you know what happens in April in Hong Kong? It's a trade show season. Global Sources Expo out at the airport. Hong Kong Trade Development Council Expo in at Wan Chai. So what every group of six students had to do was every group of six students had to do 100 interviews. 100. 100. I'm serious. 100. Yeah. Yeah, they were looking at me like that too when I told them. I said, don't worry, I'll show you how to do it. All right? We do it in one day, we go to the trade show. I took every group one by one. Okay? Some days we had two groups and we had other people to show them what to do. And then we broke each group of six into three pairs. Each pair had to do about 33 interviews. So 33 times three is 100, right? Okay, 99, okay? And then they choose one of those 100 to do their major project on. But 15% of their assessment was based on creating an infographic from the 100 interviews. That infographic they could use in their CV, and they can actually use that in their job interview. Because that's I teach you how to actually put data into a graphical way that managers like to see, not professors, what managers like to see, okay? And that's what we did. So we did 900 interviews, because there were nine groups in 9 days. Wow. And most of them had fun. But your challenge is December, there's no trade show, okay? But in January there is. Yes, there's actually two big trade shows on. And one is baby and toy products, right? All right, okay. And another one is aftermarket automobile products. So that's in Hong Kong. Then I was thinking, maybe we should go to Shenzhen. Have you ever been to the Shenzhen Expo? Exciting. I've been to it many, many times. And even bigger than the one in Hong Kong. And it's not much further away anyway. It's less than an hour and a half from Kowloon Tong. Knock Ma Chow and then two stations and you're there, bang, you know, very easy to get there. So that was one option. So I'm just thinking of the option, but I'm glad there was ones in Hong Kong here, and it may be fun, absolutely fun. And so what I have done is, normally we have a car to go over to Shenzhen, and I think the last two factory visits we went on, one or two students from the other master's course just came along. And they had fun too, because we take a team. I always have about three on a team when we go, so it's fun. And we videotape everything. That's the deal. If when we go and visit a factory, we tell them we will not come if we cannot videotape everything. And that's what we do. And they said, what do you want to videotape? I said, number one, I want to use in my teaching. And number two, we're going to give you an edited version of the video so then you can market to your customers. So you can show your customers in the UK, in USA, what your factory is really like. They don't always have to come and visit. Really? You'll do that for us? Sure. All right. And this is what I've been doing. And I absolutely love doing this. Yeah. Exciting. All right. Can't wait to see you on Thursday. Thank you. Who wants a touch screen? That's the touch screen factory we went to. You can go now. Don't. You can. This is the where they make the touch screens. See, cutting the glass. Laser cutter. This is for your iPhone. Cutting the glass for your iPhone. All right. Yeah, anyway, I don't want to bore you too much. Lots of interesting, more for Thursday, that is. So we've got lots of stuff to do.